T-Tube News. T-Tube is working on humanitarian and human right issues, protesting and condemning genocide and human right abuses that are being committed everywhere in the world, and focusing grave genocide crimes in Tigray, Ethiopia. Please subscribe, share and comment our programs. Thank you these who are supporting us. News today. Only 4% of required aid has reached Tigray during mini-truce, says WHO chief accreditation.
World Bank is sponsoring Tigray genocide, funding $4.8 billion to Ethiopia.
Only 4% of required aid has reached Tigray during mini-truce, says WHO chief accreditation, 3 weeks after the mini-truce in the Tigray region of Ethiopia. An underwhelming 4% of required food aid has reached targeted areas. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, the Director General of the World Health Organization, WHO, said less than 100 trucks had entered the region in almost a month. He said in a tweet, a truce was called 3+ weeks ago, but only 69 humanitarian trucks, 4% of the needs, have been allowed in. Situation is dire. People are dying. The siege must end for real. Food aid is delivered into Tigray, mostly by road through the Afar region, and for the situation to normalize, humanitarian aid givers say 100 trucks must enter the region with food, non-food items, and fuel every day. Read, 75% of Tigray population facing severe hunger as war rages in Ethiopia. Eritrean and Ethiopian forces are blamed for sealing off 7 million people from the world in a war that started in November 2020. They are fighting against the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF, a left-wing ethnic nationalist paramilitary group. The war in Ethiopia has left tens of thousands dead and millions displaced, as government troops and the Tigrayan People's Liberation Front battle over territory. A UN investigation found all sides in the conflict had committed atrocities, including rape. Warning, this report contains descriptions of shame. Both warring factions are blamed for gross human rights violations. The Ethiopian National Disaster Risk Management Commission, NDRMC, in a statement said TPLF's fighting of the Afar state, where the fighting has moved since the mini-truce in Tigray, had resulted in 1.3 million citizens in need of immediate food aid. However, T-Tube argues Abiy Ahmed and Isaias Afwerki are intentionally killing the people of Tigray using starvation as a weapon of war. Just like they have been using rape and gang rape as a means of war at the beginning of the genocide. TPLF or TDF is fighting only to break the siege and save the people from the genociders. The international community has to interfere and make the genociders liable. Media should not repeat the lies of the butcher Abiy Ahmed Ali like a parrot. They have to investigate the fact in the ground. They have to reconsider the complete siege and blockade of media, internet and in any communication means, including non-partition investigation. NDRMC added that the new war frontier was affecting food aid delivery in crisis spots. NDRMC public relations head Debebes Yud said in a statement, the conflict is not only increasing the displaced citizens but also the main hindrance to providing the necessary humanitarian support to the needy. The fighting in Afar could compromise the mini-truce and the possibility of peace talks. Meanwhile, to address challenges related to the conflict, such as the destruction of private and public assets, gender-based violence, sexual abuse, and hunger, the World Bank has approved an $4.8 billion International Development Association (IDA) grant for the Response Recovery Resilience for Conflict-Affected Communities in Ethiopia project. The project will support efforts to address the immediate needs of communities, rehabilitate, recover infrastructure destroyed by conflict, and increase community resilience to the impacts of conflict in a sustainable manner, said the World Bank. The project will be aimed at the Afar, Amhara, Benishangul Gumuz, Oromia, and Tigray regions, which have been highly impacted by the ongoing conflict. This is unhuman. The World Bank is sponsoring Tigray genocide. It is unthinkable to expect the butcher Abiy Ahmed to work on community resilience. He will only buy a weapon from it. The World Bank's International Development Association, IDA, was established in 1960 to help the world's poorest countries through the provision of grants for projects and programs that boost economic growth, reduce poverty, and improve poor people's lives. The act of the World Bank now is like buying armaments for the butcher Abiy Ahmed Ali. This is the extension of what it has been doing in Yemen, in Syria, in Iraq, and so many other countries. The World Bank is the big project of the sector society, the Illuminati or 666, which is destroying the world to be ruled by the New World Order. That is the Satan or devil. The Illuminati is doing its destructive role in Tigray genocide. Here is the speech of Dr. Tedros Adhanom, chief of the WHO at ACT.
Mr. President, Excellencies, dear colleagues, good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to address you today. The war in Ukraine is having a devastating consequence for the health of Ukraine's people, consequences that will reverberate for years or decades to come. There is severe disruption to health services and access to basic commodities as a result of widespread destruction of infrastructure, including health facilities. WHO has verified 43 attacks on healthcare, with 12 people killed and 34 injured, including health workers. In any conflict, attacks on healthcare are a violation of international humanitarian law. They deprive people of urgently needed care and break already strained health systems. The disruption to services and supplies in Ukraine is posing an extreme risk to people with cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, HIV, and TB, which are among the leading causes of mortality in Ukraine. Displacement, poor shelter, and overcrowded living conditions caused by the conflict are likely to increase the risk of diseases such as measles, pneumonia, and polio. Services for mental health and psychosocial support are urgently needed to help people cope with the effects of the war. There are more than 35,000 mental health patients in Ukrainian psychiatric hospitals and long-term care facilities, which are facing severe shortages of medicines, food, heating, blankets, and more. The war is also exacerbating the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic in Ukraine. With just 1/3 of the adult population fully vaccinated, this increases the risk of large numbers of people developing severe disease. Critical shortages of oxygen will have an impact on the ability to treat patients with COVID-19 and many other conditions. At least 8 facilities for producing and storing liquid oxygen have now closed, and we're seeking ways of accessing oxygen from neighboring countries and ways to deliver it safely to where it's needed. WHO is on the ground, working with the Ministry of Health and partners to support health workers and the health system to provide care to meet immediate health needs. So far, we have sent about 100 metric tons of medical supplies, including oxygen, insulin, surgical supplies, anesthetics, and blood transfusion kits, enough for 4,500 trauma patients and 450,000 primary healthcare patients for 1 month. Other equipment, including oxygen generators, electrical generators, and defibrillators, have also been delivered and we're preparing to send a further 108 metric tons. We have now established supply lines from our warehouse in Lviv to many cities of Ukraine, but challenges with access remain. We need unfettered access. We have critical supplies ready for UN joint convoys to enter difficult areas, but so far we have not been successful. Today, for example, the UN convoy to Sumy that included a WHO truck carrying critical medical supplies was unable to enter. Loads ready for Mariupol remain in staging areas and cannot proceed. Access to this and other areas is now critical. To support Ukraine's health system, WHO is coordinating the deployment of 20 emergency medical teams consisting of experts from many countries to deliver care across a range of disciplines in Ukraine and neighboring countries, which have been generous in welcoming refugees but are struggling to meet their needs, as my colleagues earlier said. Those needs are immense and include continuity of care for basic illnesses, as well as more complex issues like cancer and renal dialysis, maternal and child health, HIV and TB, sexual and reproductive health, and mental health. Refugees and many of those who remain in Ukraine are already very vulnerable, especially women and girls. Protecting them from abuse and exploitation of all kinds must be a top priority for hosting governments and for all international organizations. Mr. President, today I have three urgent requests. First, we urge the Security Council to work for an immediate ceasefire and a political solution. Prolonged conflict is in nobody's interest and will only prolong the suffering of the most vulnerable. The life-saving medicine we need right now is peace. Second, we urge all donors to support the response to humanitarian needs in Ukraine and neighboring countries, which are immense and escalating every day. Thanks to donors who front-loaded WHO's contingency fund for emergencies, we were able to respond immediately, deploying these funds were supplemented by additional funding from the UN Central Emergency Response Fund, CERF. However, to sustain the response, we call on donors to fully fund the United Nations Emergency Appeal. As the Undersecretary General said, it's only 36% so far funded. We thank those donors who have already pledged funding to meet the needs of people in Ukraine. And third, although Ukraine is rightly the focus of the world's attention, I urge you not to lose sight of the many other crises in which people are suffering. In Afghanistan, more than half the population is in need, with widespread malnutrition and a surge in measles, among many other challenges. In Ethiopia, the blockade of 6 million people in Tigray for almost 500 days has created a catastrophic food and health crisis. In the Syrian Arab Republic, more than 12 million people are in need of health assistance, almost half of them children. And in Yemen, roughly two-thirds of the population, more than 20 million people, are estimated to be in need of health assistance. Mr. President, in every case, the only solution is peace. I repeat, In every case, the only solution is peace. And our world needs peace more than ever. As if COVID is not enough, to have a devastating war like this is dangerous for the world. I thank you, and back to you.
They face conflict and displacement, but the women and girls in the Tigray region of northern Ethiopia have also been subjected to rape, other sexual violence, and slavery. Amnesty International interviewed more than 60 victims, and in a report, say soldiers from the Ethiopian and Eritrean armies, Amhara Special Forces, and militias are the main perpetrators. We met Burtukan at a refugee camp in neighboring Sudan in May, one of more than 60,000 Tigrayans who fled the fighting in northern Ethiopia. She says she was raped at the start of the conflict in November.
Four military soldiers from the Amhara got me and took me to a house. There, two of them raped me for days. They refused to give me food or water. They beat me when I tried to run away to the point I still suffer from back pains. I begged them to stop and asked them why they were doing this to me. They said that it's because I'm from Tigray.
Burtukan told us she's still haunted by her ordeal. Amnesty's report says the acts of sexual violence constitute war crimes and may amount to crimes against humanity and were intended to terrorize and humiliate the victims and their ethnic group. Some survivors have had to have surgery after being raped. Some have since tested positive for HIV. Others reported physical trauma, including bleeding, back pain, and immobility.
We are now 9 months into the Tigray conflict, and really, statements to condemn the atrocities no longer suffice. And the UN Secretary General must send to Tigray as soon as possible his team of experts on sexual violence in conflict and its special representative on the same issue.
The conflict in Tigray has displaced nearly 2 million people and left more than 5 million in need of aid. According to the United Nations, rape has been used as a weapon of war, with more than 500 cases of rape and sexual violence recorded between November and May. Several reports have been released on sexual violence in the Tigray conflict, some of which also accuse the Tigrayan People's Liberation Front, or TPLF, of atrocities. Aid groups working with victims in the refugee camps in Sudan say the known cases are just the tip of the iceberg.
You know, underreporting is everywhere. And you know, there is many factors affecting this, like feeling of shame of reporting, fear of retaliation. Maybe the survivor don't know what the service of there is service for GBV provider, GBV survivors in the camp, and all these factors is contributing to underreporting.
Ethiopia's government has previously described the allegations as propaganda. But in May, it convicted three Ethiopian soldiers and indicted 25 others for rape and other forms of sexual violence. For many survivors, justice is far from being served. Hiba Morgan, Al Jazeera.